Wow. Absolutely. Absolutely. Dialogue on Awakening, which is a different phase, you might say. It helps us in this new way. Welcome to the is it a video? I don't know what it is. Let's try not to define it. What we're asked to do is to let go of the need for some sort of a tight definition. So dedicate part of your mind to be free of a tight definition, strict definition. Okay, it doesn't have to be entirely free of definition, but all the strictures of definition, part of your mind, allow that part of your mind to be free of that. And then pay great attention. That's like an orphan that you've taken in, that part of your mind. And you say, wow, I think it'll be very valuable to have someone like this in the family, that they're not defining what, that they're free of definition. They're not trying to define what they are, what the mind is. So pay great attention to that, and that's what we do here in these videos, which is, these are really outreach of therapy as part of the outreach of the oneness, which expresses in different ways in this particular book. A formulation we would call Jesus is expressing as the oneness that we all are, that is. I call it the Dharma Kings, because there are all sorts of expressions of the oneness. Now, in this expression of the oneness, it's spoken of that there are many different ways that trigger remembrance that we're already awake. Okay. And so you can't have a universal curriculum as far as what triggers this recognition that we're already awake. However, what we're emphasizing here is there is a universal problem, and that is panic, and that is our expectations. So that is universal. Whatever form our expectations take, which can be extremely varied and diverse, the fact is that when we go past our expectations, however they may be structured, we feel this sense of shock because we're not sure what to expect anymore. And if we don't know how to hold on to something that is abstract at that point, which we call wow, as our expectation. In other words, it's undefined, and yet it's still the frameless frame, you might say. Wow is this frameless frame. If we don't hold on to that and feel comfortable, say, I'm experiencing what I expect. I'm experiencing this frameless frame of, it's wow. Yeah, I'm okay. Even though I've lost all my expectations, I don't know what happened to them, they disappeared. But here in its place is this wow, which is great. I'm comfortable with that. Because I've been nurturing this definition-free area of my mind, right? Where there's no strict definitions allowed. And so I'm used to it. So unless we do that, we're going to go into panic for sure. We're going to go into panic, and then panic causes us to backslide back into strict definition and all sorts of defenses. So that is universal. That is universal. So our emphasis here is on the ground, the fundamental aspect of going beyond expectations and what takes place when we do that. And it's very troublesome. We feel, you know, lost at sea. Wait a minute. We feel lost at sea. And I've got my boogie board here. That's why it's nice to have a boogie board. At least you can hold on to the boogie board. The boogie board's like a wow. It's not a surfboard. You can't really stand up and ride. But at least it's something you can grab a hold of. I'm holding on in this ocean. I don't know, you know, where I am. But I got this boogie board, and I'm okay. So really, when you go beyond your expectations into the frameless frame, out of the blue, this ancient groove arises, and you cannot discern any context. So there's no, what's the frame? Well, you can't discern any frame at all. But what we say now is, oh, I know that. That's the frameless frame. That's the wow frame. I'm comfortable with that. It's like having a boogie board out in the middle of the ocean. Suddenly you find yourself, what happened to the land? It's kind of like you're in the water and you're used to the beach and the mountain and the beach and the surrounding area. And you say, oh, I'm fine. I'm just kind of playing in the ocean here. And then suddenly something happens and you get turned around and you lose sight of the familiar beach and the landscape and all that. And suddenly all you see is ocean. And you say, what happened? I don't know what happened. And you say, oh my gosh. You go into shock. Where's the beach? Where do I go into shore? It's gone. Those are expectations are gone. And then you say, what do I do? And you say, oh, but I had this boogie board here. So I'll just hold on to that boogie board. And I'm fine. This is comfortable. I'm used to this. And I know after a while, and I settle down and calm down, I'll start to see the shore again. It's just my whole notion of what the shore is. Suddenly I lost it. But another clearer notion will come into play here. Okay. So if I just hold on to the boogie board, I'll be fine. I don't need to be surfing anything right now. Just a little boogie board. Perfect analogy. So no matter what the landscape or beach looks like, and it could be extremely varied throughout the universe, all of us who believe that we're asleep in a dream trying to induce a change in reality, no matter what it looks like, when we go beyond, when we're willing to let go of the definition of what it is, it will seem to disappear on us, and shock will take place, and then we must block panic from taking place, because if you start panicking, you'll forget all about your boogie board, and you'll start swimming, trying to swim into shore. I don't know where shore is, I just start swimming desperately, and you burn yourself out, and then you'll sink. But if you just say, oh, I got my boogie board, let me just hold on to it, let me just float here for a while, I know what happened, I dropped my definition, I dropped in trying to induce abnormality through definition, trying to define freedom, trying to induce abnormality. Definition is an attempt to induce abnormality in reality in order to try to change it so that we can say we're greater than God. And so I dropped that, and I don't really have a structure or framework right now. I'm not really sure what to think. Just realize that you've done that. That's the whole purpose, what we're trying to do. And yet we have this wow board. Okay, the boogie board's a wow board. And we just hold on to that. And just float and relax. We float and relax. I'm fine. I know that some frame will reconstitute in some way. And it'll be more abstract than before, but it'll be wonderful. And no panic happens. So this is a universal teaching here. It's a universal teaching. We're not saying what words or definitions will trigger your going beyond your expectations, because that varies in everyone to greater or lesser extent. So we're not trying to say we have the magic words to trigger this. But the trigger will automatically arise for you once you're confident that you can handle this temporary loss of expectations, which is shocking, and you know how to block panic. This is what we're saying, and this is a universal teaching. Absolutely, it is. This principle is the same in everyone, everywhere. It is the principle of because we're trying to induce abnormality, a change in reality, it leads to what we call expectations. It's amazing. As we relax here for a moment, It's got to be some Facebook thing. I, you know, they want your phone number there, but what happens is somehow people are able to text you now, and I keep getting text messages from Facebook. It's crazy. Here you go. So-and-so updated his status. Questioner, some people die so painful. HTTP link. Reply with your comment or like. I get this all the time. What am I supposed to do? I've got to go into Facebook and take my phone number out of there. But, you know, at least it reminds me of how vacuous Facebook really is compared to what we're doing here. You know, it just is not on the same wavelength, so to speak, as what we're doing here. It's a stall out. It's a beautiful stall out. Okay, Facebook is a beautiful stall out. But we don't want to stall out. Okay? We don't want to stall out. So beautiful stall outs are quite dangerous, but we can't dispense with beauty altogether. Okay? So I did this video last night of what was it? Dropping definition or something like that. Devaluing definition. Devaluing definition with Chopin's second concerto, the second movement of that. And which is just stupendous, but it's what does Jesus say? He says something about this. Let me see what he says. As you see yourself dancing around the periphery of love and experiencing more of the emotional aspects of it, then your definition of truth will be very perceptual, and it will appear to change as your understanding changes. As you allow yourself to become more deeply enmeshed, to give up more of the limitations to understanding love and simply become the act of extending love, then you have given up more of the conditions under which you are willing to give love, and your perception becomes one of knowing the meaning of love. So as you see yourself dancing around the periphery of love and experiencing more of the emotional aspects of it, then your definition of truth will be very perceptual and will appear to change as your understanding changes. So this is what's called romanticism, and this is what the era of Chopin was, which he was... I think he was born in. He grew up. I think he wrote the concerto in 1820, number one and number two, which are beautiful dancing around love and experiencing these emotions around it, and putting that into music. And of course, back then, what these artistic people, the culture was, is you have this ideal, and for men it was always this unattainable woman, unattainable female figure, and he had Constantia, I think it was, who he was expressing his love for her, and she didn't even know it. Okay, usually the muse back didn't even necessarily know that the composer had this emotional infatuation with her, and he was trying to say, how can I extend this emotional love to her, so it can reach her, and perhaps she'll hear this in some concert hall, this concerto, and say, oh, that was for me. Yeah. So this is romanticism, and it causes an emotional, a tremendous stress and strain. That's why the artists like Mozart and Chopin and many others became, you know, neuroasthenics. And I lived in that whole romantic era. I was just after Chopin growing up. And his music, of course, influenced Liszt, which greatly influenced me in the Romantic era, in my previous life. And so going back on this, it's like, oh my gosh, it's deja vu. I'm going back and say, I remember all that time, and then I carried it with me into this lifetime. So I was always setting up this unattainable ideal and then trying to extend, see, how can I extend a beautiful dance of love to this ideal, and this then brings out, you know, the artistry. How can I do that? And so Chopin, the concerto number two, which is just really is extraordinary. But at that time he was young and 20 and hadn't burned out yet. But pretty soon he'd burned out very, very badly, and had this haunted, and I know exactly how that feels because I burned out this lifetime. I didn't burn out the previous lifetime. I somehow kicked a can down the road to this lifetime. But in this lifetime, I was completely burned out by the time I was 20 from trying to figure out, you know, how can I put together this perfect perceptual emotional dance that enables this unattainable ideal that doesn't even know I exist to know my love for them, you know. The love for the world, for the love for everyone. How can I put that in a artistic dance? And it consumed my nervous system and my thinking, and I couldn't stop. It was like a constant obsession that was going on, because I didn't finish it last lifetime. The music didn't quite express what I wanted to express. So I came in here, I said, I've got to be able to express it properly. And it completely burned me out into a nervous breakdown. And I became that haunted figure that Chopin was in the 1900s. But even in listening to the second movement of the Concerto No. 2 by Chopin, which he puts together stuff that's just, you know, extraordinary. And listen to it, I just take my hat off to him. I sit at his feet. I say, you know, I never attained to anything like that. You know, I was a Chopin wannabe, you might say, actually, and I never reached that. So I bow to Chopin. You know, as far as what he did, but of course it didn't satisfy him. He ended up with George Sand, this baroness, having this terrible relationship. They all seem to have these terrible relationships because they can, you know, the muse always says, nah, that didn't really reach me. You know, it wasn't good enough. Because the muse wants to be reached, and of course the muse is never reached. The muse can never be reached because it's all superficial. It's all definitional. It's all structural. It's all about being reached by love, but not being love. What Jesus tells us here, the one self expressing, as Jesus tells us in this book, wonderful book, Dialogue on Awakening by Tom and Linda Carpenter, that we are love. It's not that love reaches us. No, we are it. We are reality. We are intrinsicness. There's only intrinsicness. We're not asleep. No one's asleep. We're only having this perspective, imagining that we could somehow be asleep to what we are. But we're really not. And so there's nothing to reach. There's no one to reach and nothing to reach. So what we're trying to do is leave romanticism behind. And it's been very difficult for me because I was one of the historically chief exponents of romanticism. The whole notion of that, and of course that was, I grew up in that. I mean, it was just everywhere, and you couldn't escape it. And if you were really sensitive, I was extremely sensitive, and so it was how you expressed your sensitivity, and it lasted for hundreds of years, until modernism came along. And I fought against modernism because I said that's a degradation of the beautiful expressions of emotionalism, romanticism is, which tends to, we think it was extending love, you know, we almost did it, you know. Looks like we made it, almost made it, but we didn't quite make it. We burned out. Icarus flying close to the sun. So I come back here into being reborn into this modern era, which I find horrible. It's more an expression of fear. Like, how can we make fear more attractive to ourselves? Because we feel like we couldn't do it through romanticism, through love, the superficial expressions of love, as Jesus says, as we dance around love. It's worth repeating this. Where you are within this process of loving determines your ability to understand truth. let's give the context to this, because this is really important. It's vitally important that we recognize the different eras, Romanticism and Modernism, and what that's about, because we're kind of trapped in it. We feel sort of trapped in it. Tom asked this question: do you feel that there is any finality in truth? Is there anything that is true for all time, or do we enter into different perception levels? And the oneness expressing as Jesus responds, in its purest sense, the word quote-unquote truth would be completely interchangeable with the word creator or God or love, and in that context, it would be eternal. It would not be finite. When you use the term, quote-unquote, is truth fixed, you must then ask yourself the question, is creation fixed? And I will tell you, it is not. It is an ever-changing affair, but its meaning is absolutely unchanging in that it describes a feeling of absolutely accepting love. And we might call this here intrinsicness. Intrinsicness. I'm getting a call. Now, this is not Facebook. This is actually... One moment, please. One moment, please, here.
The rings on it, oh really, I took it, ring shank, huh, okay, I got you, okay, so when do you need that, you need it ASAP, right now, by noon, okay, I'll get it over to you, okay, great, okay, see you in a while, though, thank you, bye.
Someone needs something, but we can continue here. So, as Jesus says, Tom asks the question, do you feel is there any finality in truth? He says, well, the finality is that it describes it's absolutely unchanging, and that it describes a feeling of absolutely accepting love, which we call an intrinsicness. That can't possibly change. Where you are within this process of loving determines your ability to understand truth. Determines your ability to understand truth. Well, understand is a tricky term, isn't it? We want to go beyond understanding, but for the purpose of getting this out, the term understanding is used. So, where you are within this process of loving determines your ability to understand truth. As you see yourself dancing around the periphery of love and experiencing more of the emotional aspects of it, then your definition of truth will be very perceptual, and it will appear to change as your understanding changes. As you allow yourself to become more deeply enmeshed, to give up more of the limitations to understanding love and simply become the act of extending love, then you have given up more of the conditions under which you are willing to give love, and your perception becomes one of knowing the meaning of truth. So, because the words are being used here, we kind of have to dance with the words, okay? Whenever words are being used, you have to dance with it and not get stuck in it. So I can transpose what's being said in my mind. and saying it could be said this way, it could be said this way, it could be simpler, it could be like that, like that, like that. But you have to have somebody who's willing to say something so that this puts you to the test and to the focus. And as you go along, you have to transpose it. I believe that Chopin's number, chair number two, was composers who came later actually transposed a little bit of it, changed a little bit here, changed a little bit there. But it's so beautiful. They say, "Wow, I really want to work on this. This. Can I make this better? Can I make it a little bit better?" But if it wasn't really wonderful to start with, they wouldn't even bother, right? So, the one self is putting out this explanation to Tom Carpenter, and we're hearing this, and we're saying, "Aha! We have other contexts that we're aware of, and so we can say, yeah." It's very beautiful, and I might see it this way. I might not use the term understanding. I might not, the act of love, I might not use that. I might use the term intrinsicness. I wouldn't use becoming. I would say we're already it. But there'd be some transposing take place. But it's because the intent is so beautiful here from the oneself, you see. And so we pick up on that. Jesus is trying to reshape our expectations here. It's the intent is to reshape our expectations and having faith and trust that this can be done and we will do it. That's what's important. Not technically the exact words, the structure of what he said. He says, you know, so that if we don't understand what we're getting at here, if we don't feel it, if we can't dance in transposing it and confidence in this, then we'll fall into dogma. And which is what happens with religion, is too many people forget to dance with it. And we're not trying to dance just for the sake of dancing. We're dancing, as Jesus says, as you get more and more enmeshed in the intrinsicness of it, I would say, and more familiar with it, as our expectations get more and more familiar with no definition at all. Then he certainly says your definitions are going to change. Absolutely, they will. So as you pay attention to this more and more and more, like when I first read this, I said, okay, that's it. This is what Jesus said. That's it. Now I'm saying this is the one self, and I can transpose it this way, and this helps me get past my expectations. The purpose is to get past our expectations of any definition whatsoever. And realize we are it. There's only intrinsicness. There's nothing else. So is it fixed? Well, intrinsicness. When you see the question itself is tricky. There's only intrinsicness. So the question is it fixed? Well, there's no possibility that of being something else. There's no something else. So is it fixed? It's a dualistic question, isn't it? It means it's possible that it can't be fixed. Fixed and not fixed, that can't arise in reality as even a consideration. There's only intrinsicness. So how could the question of is it fixed arise? Those type of questions can't even arise. And therefore, the answers can't really arise either, right? So it's really a state with no questions, no answers. No questions and no answers. So even though we have this book where Tom's giving questions to the one self, expressing as Jesus, what Jesus keeps doing is keep working us back towards beyond what we expect to hear as answers. We should get used to no answers and no questions. No answers and no questions. And to let this ancient groove of no answers and no questions arise and then experience it as, oh, this is the frameless frame. Yeah, the frameless frame. But the work of working on our expectations has to begin somewhere. So the One Self put out some of these books of A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, Dialogue on Awakening, and put these out to like a beautiful concerto by Chopin, and it starts like, oh, the beauty. It attracts us, you see. The way Jesus is used, Jesus, the one self through as Jesus, uses words and expressions and how he dances around with words and definitions to help us. We say, oh, that's so beautiful. But then we start hearing, say, hey, it feels like it's calling me to something even more beautiful. Something that is intrinsic. It feels like intrinsicness is calling. Right? Feels like intrinsicness. Something even greater is calling. And so I got my boogie board here, and I'm shocked by this. No definition and no understanding. No understanding. There's nothing to understand. There's nothing about reality to understand. There's nothing separate to understand it. There's no position of understanding. There's never a position of needing to understand. Never a position of needing to understand. So even the words that are being used here, you have to dance with those words, and you may transpose them. Okay? Yeah. In fact, it's inevitable. To some degree, you'll have to transpose them. But the practice that we're using, this of blocking panic, is essential. The panic of, I don't know, you know, how to function. Okay, that's the panic. I'm not sure how to experience. I'm not sure how to keep experiencing. I've lost my parameters about that. I've lost my expectations of what I am going to experience. What do I expect to experience? Expectations mean what you expect to experience. And when you lose those parameters, you feel like you're like in an abyss. You feel like shock, like I'm in sort of an abyss. Longchampa points out that the problem we have is we think the absence of delusion is an abyss. Well, to some extent, that's how we experience it, because when we drop our expectations of what we expect to experience, it does feel like we don't know what to experience temporarily. So we have to have faith that this is temporary. Temporary. And go through this, as they call it, the way of the cross, the suffering. As Jesus carrying the cross, it's the suffering of like, wow, I don't really know how to, you know, what to expect in my experiencing. It's kind of scary. It's kind of shocking. But we have to accept, well, and to stay with the shock and say, okay, it's shock, but I'm not going to try and force the issue. When we try to force the issue when we're in shock, it turns into panic. It turns into panic. And then panic is so painful that we will grab a hold, start clutching at straws, and fixate. We'll fixate very strongly, which we don't want to do that. And before you know it, we've jumped into some preset expectations of our experiencing that fixates us in some role. And we'll jump into some role, okay? And then we'll start role-playing, and then we're very unhappy and miserable again. And we say, ah, what happened? I lost the spiritual path. It seemed to, it's vanished from me. I can't find it, because we're stuck in a role to try to get rid of the panic. So we've lost our spontaneity. We're now expected to play a role. So we're all unhappy because we're playing roles. Okay. Now, this is, of course, been very well known. Psychotherapy understands this very well. And what they, you know, we kind of say, well, I want to play a better role. And no, you need to be more spontaneous and flow with the moment. That'll be, that's where your happiness is. Yeah. But we keep falling back into roles, even the role of playing spontaneity. We can even turn that into a role as we define it, as we go back into definition. So when we panic, we tend to revert to definition, and in the aspect of our mind, what we're trying to get used to, which is spontaneity, when we go into panic, we will flip over into strict definitions, and we start trying to define ourselves as a role. Even the role of a composer, of dancing around the periphery of love. And that's a role that people in this world, they as they're stuck in roles, all they can do is feel they're on the periphery of intrinsicness, of love. of being, and therefore they're desperate for some sort of embellishment, some sort of beautiful icing on that cake, that heavy cake of playing a role. So they love entertainment, and they love those who will entertain them. And yet the ones who are doing the entertaining, they're stuck in a role also, actually, of trying to please those who are stuck in roles, heavily stuck in roles, and have no capability to work their way out of it. They don't know how to do it. They feel it's an abyss. As soon as they start dropping a role, they feel, oh, I'm in an abyss, I don't have to do it. I'm backing over, back in the role, jump back into it. So that gets us nowhere. That profiteth us nothing at all. So you really have to drop out of the role of being this creative master to a large extent. I still do embellishment and creativity. That's a secondary. And I try to reach out to those who feel they need that. And but at the same time, it's a bridge to start doing skillful spiritual practice here, which is going past our expectations, feeling the shock, grabbing hold of the wow and saying, I'm good, I'll just float here for a while, and blocking the panic. And that way we go more and more and more to true spontaneity, the true spontaneity. And we're less captivated by entertainment. So I see all these, you know, summer season, all these summer concerts and stuff. I used to live for entertainment and try to understand, you know, what can I do to entertain others better? How can I be more artistic and beautiful? That was my entire life. And so concerts, okay, you know, what do people enjoy now? What can I do? So I thought that was my role. And now it's like I see, you know, summer concerts, I'm not even interested in even who's playing, what's this, I'm not even interested in it at all, which is extraordinary. I've gotten out of that role, which was really the most painful role you can be in, actually, is trying to please those, everyone else who are stuck in roles, demanding, you know, that your role is to please them. They say, well, God gave you these gifts. That's a very dangerous thing to hear. God gave you these gifts of being able to entertain us as we're stuck in a role. So it's your role to entertain us. You gotta be careful when people invoke God in that way. They're really not invoking God. They're invoking that the opposite, an absence of God, the God of being absent from God, is what they're invoking. They're trying to have an absence of reality, to experience an absence of reality. And they're saying, your job is to make us, as we're struggling with this, to entertain us, so we keep trying to do it. And there's no worse role than that. It's the worst. So those who get stuck into such a role, like others demanding that they do that, they eventually work to get out of that. You might see, you know, Chopin, a reincarnation of Chopin, he might be working extremely diligently to get out of that. He says, no, I've had enough of that. You know, the moving towards more inclusivity of love and then falling away from it, and the moving towards it and the falling away from it, and you know, the emotions that we feel as we flirt with intrinsicness and then feel the abyss, the shock, and I must depart from this. Oh, you know, the pathos of departing from it, you know, and he expresses this pathos and this, the harmonies, as the harmonies sort of dissolve and become more and more dense and more structured. So he sort of goes from this soft spontaneity to more and more structure, more and more heaviness, and more locked into a rollness in the music. So he's sort of expressing the emotions we feel as we are in this dance with trying to really depart from intrinsicness, and how we keep running back towards it and saying, oh, yeah, but I need to depart. I must depart from you. You're unreachable. Oh, and I have no choice but to depart. So this is what art plays with, this notion of, you know, deep down we crave, you know, the feeling of intrinsicness, and yet since we're trying to abandon it, we're playing with this issue of abandonment and the pathos of that. And so yes, I miss it, but I can't have it anymore, you know. And so it fluctuates, it oscillates between hope and fear, the oscillation between hope and fear, which is artists express that in various ways, and Chopin expressed it in a most extraordinarily beautiful way. Almost as if floating in it. But ultimately, dissatisfying. Of course. So when we experience that the mind functioning normally, it's beyond art. It's beyond art. So we don't. Art is being means you're very stuck actually, in a role, in definition, in abandonment. When mind is function, when you're aware of the normal functioning of mind, when we stop pretending to be abnormal, it's beyond art. You cannot express it as art actually. There's no pathos. There's no pathos. There's no oscillation. There's no hope and fear involved. So there's no audience to engage. You realize there is no audience to engage it out. So how can you say you have art? You don't. You can't, technically, you cannot be an artist. You be awake and be an artist, both, because there's no audience to engage. Not in an art, in a way of art, no. Because the point of it is for the audience is to realize they're not an audience, is to drop the role of being an audience and be normal mind, instead of trying to pretend to be abnormal mind, where we somehow are an audience for truth, that truth is supposed to be playing something for us, entertaining us, but we're an audience to be reached by truth, so to speak. That's what has to be dropped. We are the truth. We are intrinsicness. We are normality. There's only the normal. You know, there's no question of anything other than that. So we don't even put it into a subject-object sort of format at all. You know, normal. We can say normal, but reality doesn't have any viewpoint of itself. Doesn't have any viewpoint of itself. It doesn't have a non-viewpoint, because that's also a viewpoint. That's just, that doesn't have any viewpoint of itself one way or the other at all. There's, you know, zero need for that. It doesn't, and to try and have a viewpoint of it is an attempt to be abnormal, to create abnormality. It's the frameless frame. But for our purposes, we will still feel that there's some viewpoint, it's just that we can't discern it. So it's very important here, as we're getting very close to what we really want, which is to be normal. We already are normal. It's to drop pretense that we're not normal. We're getting very close to that. It's very important that we realize there's this intermediate step in that we, even when we drop pretense, we'll still, out of the habit, sort of expect expectations, is that we say, well, there's some frame, I can't perceive it. It's the imperceptible perception. It's the frameless frame. And we have to become comfortable with this sort of language, the way using language this way, the frameless frame. So we're not trying to completely abandon language. We're still using it. We're not trying to completely abandon concepts and perception, etc. But we're giving a new purpose to it. In the new way, we give a new purpose to it. The new purpose to it is where we're at is very important. The frameless frame, the imperceptible perception. We say, yeah, intrinsicness, I'm feeling it, the peace of God, intrinsicness. It's perceptible, but it's imperceptibly perceptible. So this feels like a bridge, you see, it feels like a bridge. There's a bridge there. I just can't discern exactly what it is, the bridge, actually. But I can feel it. So we devalue definition, but still, in our devaluing, we still are using definition, the frameless frame, for instance, the frameless frame. Yeah, there's this frame around this ancient groove has arisen, and it's just abidance is happening. You know, I'm abiding, but I can't discern the abidance. I can't discern my abidance, so to speak. But I'm aware that you know, there's abidance. It's a frameless frame. It's a frameless frame. There's a framework around my abidance, but I just can't discern what it is. It's indiscernible. It's imperceptible. So this is intermediate step. And we must not allow the gamesmanship, spiritual gamesmanship, any slack. Otherwise, we're in trouble. So we cannot put up with those who will say, yeah, but it's really beyond that. You need to go beyond that. It you can't define it at all. That's called spiritual gamesmanship. Because Jesus says God takes the last step, and we're not to concern ourselves with it at all. Okay? It's not our concern at all here. So our concern is this ancient groove, to be in this groove, but it's a beingless being, so to speak, an abidance-free abidance. I'm in this abidance-free abidance. I'm in this imperceptible perception. I'm in this frameless frame. So we needed to use language and concepts in this way. And this way, we're able to be in the world, function with others, without spiritual gamesmanship, and help others, okay, allow this ancient groove to arise out of nowhere. Out of nowhere, this ancient groove is present. Out of nowhere. Now, is nowhere still a term? Out of nowhere, sure. But it conveys such an abstraction that it allows the presence to be present. We're able to feel it. Continuously feel it as long as we allow ourselves this luxury, and God allows this for us. Jesus says it. Absolutely. God is not saying, no, you must go beyond this right away. No. God says, get used to this. Get used to, expect this, the frameless frame. Expect the frameless frame. So we're pragmatic and not into spiritual gamesmanship here. The lazy love spiritual gamesmanship. They're not willing to practice it. They're not willing to take the way of the cross and go through the shock. And you know, it's the shock. It's kind of painful. It's kind of uncomfortable. And so they're just stuck in the role of being, you know, the role of being a spiritual gamesman. And that's a miserable role. It's a miserable role. Very miserable role. Very miserable role. And we've seen enough of that to realize, wow, I don't want that role. I don't want to trade, you know, I don't want to go from the miserable role of trying to entertain everyone who's stuck in roles and make them happy as a sublime entertainer. I don't want to go from that role into the role of being a spiritual, you know, the role of spiritual gamesmanship. I mean, that might even be worse than entertaining everybody. That might even be the worst role possible. Because our expectations have to settle down to such an extent that we're ultimately willing to drop any notion that expectation is even possible, which is pure spontaneity. And as Jesus says, you cannot really stay in this world for long if that step is taken. You cannot. And we were, that was showcased by Sri Sri Ananda Maya Ma to us, so that really hit home. And she said, beyond this bliss that I'm expressing and you're experiencing, and she says, there's actually the great bliss, she called it, the great bliss. But when she would go into the great bliss, she stopped functioning here. And her body, her body would be inert, like it was dead. No pulse, no breathing, cold as ice, frozen. And would remain in that condition sometimes for days and days at an end, until she finally came out of the great bliss. And they had to revive her functioning here. It was very difficult. That happened many, many times. And so they were very, very careful not to attract her into the great bliss. And so those who were close to her were very jittery about this. And so they tried to, some things would attract her into the great bliss, and she would just, her functioning would just vanish here, would vanish. So we have this wonderful, very clear example of exactly what Jesus has warned us about. And so we're very, very aware that our job here is to get our expectations so tenuous, so abstract, without trying to drop them altogether, okay? Without attempting to drop it altogether. That ultimately, the final step can be taken down the road when the issue of our functioning here or not is no longer an issue at all, okay? But in order to be helpful here, we need to settle for just the bliss, okay, the bliss of the frameless frame, the abidance-free abidance, the imperceptible perception that certainly will enable, out of the blue, enable bliss to arise out of the blue, just out of nowhere, arise out of nowhere. It's arising out of nowhere, okay? It will certainly allow that, and then that will help others greatly, attract them to practicing and working as we have worked, as we are working here. You have to be attracted to it. For instance, if you didn't have these beautiful classical composers, I mean, how would you be attracted to that, right? I grew up in a previous life with, you know, Chopin being played everywhere. And Mozart and all these great composers, just, you know, Bach, all these beautiful, beautiful music was everywhere. It was in the streets, it was in the concert halls, it was flooding out, you know, it was the culture. And it really was beautifully done. And so you hear this and you say, wow, I want to be immersed in this beauty, and I'm going to try and help others be immersed in it also. But I really didn't succeed. I listen to my music now that I composed in my previous life, and I don't see any beauty in it at all. I don't. And what I see is cleverness. So it expressed, I was trying to say, is there a clever way? Perhaps I realized that this beautiful way didn't quite do it. And so I said, can I sort of use the structure of the beautiful way, the romantic way, but find a way that was sneak into it? can you sneak into it? The beautiful way was too obvious. Can we find a way that seems to hold back some? And so there was purpose to what I did, but technically, I mean, listen to it now, I said, well, it's not beautiful. But many people really thought it was tremendous. Arthur Rubinstein, the maybe the greatest pianist of the 20th century, he said that he loved my music the best of all. He said it was the best of all. I said, what? But apparently, it was more challenging. It was very challenging to dance on the edge of beauty without really being beautiful, so to speak. So that's what I did. Is this great complexity and subtlety of not quite committing, a lack of commitment, so to speak. And trying to blur the edges of romanticism, of the pathos of approaching the love, and then I reject being rejected. You know, maybe this is it. Oh, I was rejected. Trying to blur all of that, so it's sort of a blurry sort of music that I composed. But I don't even like it at all now. I mean, I guess. That it, you know, it had a, it was an attempt. It was a different, quite, it's sort of a different attempt. So it was legitimate. Many, many people thought it was just absolutely the best ever, tremendous. But if you want something beautiful, you wouldn't really go there. It's more of a mind game sort of thing, of. Yeah, can we blur the beauty of it all and still maybe perhaps that, you know, let's not be so obvious about our approach. Let's play hard to get, so to speak. Let's play hard to get, but still very, very interestingly, like I'm not really that interested, you know, but I'm very, very sophisticated. So maybe you're interested in me, you know, that kind of thing. but it's not this beautifully... the flowerful, gorgeous, trilly stuff, you know. It's not. And if you're into all that, it's not that. So right now I feel like, you know, give me some beautiful flowers, and I say, and the music I compose was not that. So really I'm at a point like, well, that doesn't do it either. That didn't do it. That for sure didn't do it. Wow. But it did help us take a step back from romanticism without plunging into modernism, which is what I was trying to do. I was saying, look, yeah, romanticism isn't quite it, but modernism is definitely not it either. I mean, wow, modernism is really just saying maybe we can be so afraid of intrinsicness that we can really abandon it. Let's work on our fear of it and see if we can make a fear attractive. So I was trying to make love attractive, but I said, maybe we're being too obvious. Let's play hard to get. But modernism is not playing hard to get. It's just flat out saying, I don't want to be gotten. You know, we don't need you. Love, we don't need you. Intrinsics, we don't need you. We're going to successfully abandon you. So I was trying to prevent modernism from gaining traction. At the same time, trying to say, yeah, technically romanticism, that's not quite it. But let's not throw the baby out with the bathwater. Well, it didn't really work, did it? Because we certainly have modernism in all its hideousness now. And we can go to Chopin and listen and we say, oh my gosh, you know, we threw this away for modernism. And going back and digging, you know, into the ideology of that of the concertos, I sort of remembered my previous life in the mood of romanticism and all of that, and how beautiful it was, and how attuned we were to beauty. You know, just a flower petal is enough to write a symphony about. You know, really. It's just everything was a trigger for beauty. And that's how I was wired. I you know, the slightest anything, is enough. For this to roll out this whole approach to it, you know. Uh-oh. Another call. Okay.
I think I do. You can push it out. You got the talk there. Yeah, you got it right there. You need some PL sub-4 adhesive, right? Is that what you need? Okay, I think I have some tubes for that. Yeah, small ones. Smalls, I think I have smalls, yeah. Okay, so those two things. All right, good. Good.
So, you know, here you have someone who's not a dilettante, really, because I've been at this issue very much central to it for quite some time. Previous lives, this life. So it's not just, you know, blind luck or something that I'm attuned to the oneself expressing as the Dharma kings, Jesus, Nandamayama, Longchenpa, Manjushri, Padmasambhava, Ramaharshi, Jamin Kanchi, Choki Lodro. It's not just, you know, a whim that's brought it about. I've been totally focused on, you know, how can we be happy? You know, how can we feel the beauty that we seem to be missing, you know, the spontaneity. And at the center of this issue for a long time, in the real center of it, trying to find the answer. And so looking back now, I said, my gosh, we threw out the baby with the bathwater, but we don't want to go back to romanticism, but we certainly don't want modernism. Okay, so we need the new way, which is really spiritual practice, which is really bliss, which really allows out of nowhere bliss to arise out of nowhere, out of no context whatsoever, actually. Out of no, the context-free context, out of no discernible framework at all. The frameless frame. Bliss arises from the frameless frame. This is what we have to get to, because neither romanticism nor modernism will remotely satisfy us, okay? And it will drive us either into a nervous breakdown through too much attenuation in romanticism, or into becoming some sort of, you know, reptile dinosaur in wallowing in super heavy fear. You know, it will drive us in one of those two directions, and both of those directions are horrible. Horrible, horrible, horrible. So much so that you can't believe how horrible it is. You will be amazed at how horrible it is, which is the saving grace. You say, how in the world could I possibly have got myself in such a horrible situation? It'll intrigue you. Prevent your suicide. It's so intriguing. You say, well, I don't want to kill myself. This is amazing. This is so horrible. I have to find out, how is this possible? All right, so that's the saving grace, actually. I met this amazing man yesterday. Amazing man. And he's at the crossroads, and he realizes it. He said, I couldn't find it. It was amazing. He was at the pinnacle of some of these action sports of surfing and skateboarding. And he said he was consumed by it. He says, you know, how do I have to get 10-foot aerials today, but how do I go higher than that? And I know all these tricks, but I have to do them all perfectly today, and I have to go even further, because I it's not it yet. And he said it consumed him, and he said it was doom, the path of doom is how he called it, the path of doom. And I said, I understand what you're talking about. I hear what you're saying. Yeah. And he was there. He was there. He skated, for heaven's sakes, he skated with Rodney Mullins, skateboarded. You know, he skateboarded with all the greats. And he was that. He was that. And he showed me that the scars of the accidents, you know, horrible accidents. He had so many horrible accidents. Because he said, you have to push yourself further and further and further. And there's no end to it. He said, he calls it the path of doom. How right he is. And he's still on that path of doom. He said, I'm not sure what to do. I'm not sure how to come out of this, you know. Well, you've got to get on the path to bliss. Okay? There's no way around it. And bliss, as exemplified by Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, as truly exemplified, as a functional bliss. She exemplified functional bliss. Okay, and in our modern world, that's what we need. We need to be reassured that we can have functional bliss. She was uber functional, even though she was in seamless bliss. always in seamless bliss. She was also uber functional. Now, Rama Maharshi was in seamless bliss as well, but he was in this, just the silent, not hardly functioning at all mode of just silent sitting. For us, in the modern, super modernism, this is a bit scary. It's a bit scary because we feel, I mean, goodness sakes, I once asked someone who was professing to be a spiritual teacher, I said, you're saying this bliss, but I have to be functional. My God, I have to drive these roads constantly, and I'm almost dodging accidents all the time. I need a functional bliss. And he couldn't quite understand what I was talking about. But so I didn't go see him again, because this is central to our question. We are pressured so much to function to such a high extent. I mean, I have to be dancing on my toes constantly to function. I'm driving constantly through very, very treacherous sort of situations in a job where there's all sorts of dangers. So I say, yeah, bliss, but it's got to be a functional bliss. And Sri Srinadamai Ma highlighted this functional bliss, very functional bliss, which was extraordinary. I saw this. Oh, you can do it. I saw it. You can do this. Wow. That was an eye-opener. No excuses. But in order to do it, then your conceptual mind, definitional mind, has to still be engaged in functionality. But you must have softened it all up so it's the frameless frame. You say, sure, it's the functionless functioning that I'm engaged in. And not get trapped into a role, okay? So it is possible for us. Not allow anyone to pin you into a role. They'll see it, say, it's wonderful. Now here's the role I want you to fulfill. And you must not get trapped to it. And Sri Srinadamai Ma never got trapped into that. Everyone tried to trap her into it. But she was the great Houdini, you know? The great spiritual Houdini who done it. Never got trapped into a role. She would... So I always prayed to her. You know, I always pray, I always supplicate her and saying, look, you did what I must do. So please have mercy on us all. Because she knows how to do it, obviously. She was in this shining bliss, always in this shining bliss, yet nobody could trap her into a role. And yet she was still socializing and functioning beautifully all the time with this shining bliss. Not even the role of some uber guru, actually. She didn't even get trapped in that. You see, many get trapped into that. But she would not even trapped in that. No, I'm just a crazy little child. You know, your crazy little sister or friend. I'm nobody's guru. She wouldn't get even trapped in that one. Which is super important. Super important. So truly, I do supplicate Sri Srinadamai Ma perhaps more than any, because I know she knows how to do it. I know that she knows how to do it. And I got nowhere else to go. You got to know how to do this. You have to be able to do it. So, you know, we're at her feet saying, yeah, bring us into clarity of how to do this. We have no choice. We have no choice. People of the book, who have that history of being of the book, so to speak, very, very literate throughout history, very sophisticated, not most people are literate throughout history, but there are those who weren't. The approach of a book, they feel more comfortable within that approach. But I know that I have to be more fluid than that. I don't want to get trapped in that role of being bookish or being someone who is playing to the bookish crowd. I want to be more spontaneous than that. So Sri Srinadamai Ma is this ideal example of not getting trapped in any of that academic of the bookness, nor guru-ness, and yet shining bliss to everyone under all circumstances. Absolute spontaneity. But but still having the facade of functioning in a social structure in the modern world, within modernism, really. So we're right here in the heart of it, really. We're just getting used to being in the heart of it. We're really in the heart of it. There's no question. I don't have any question about that. The heartless, the heart-free heart, the centerless center. We're really in the centerless center of it, the frameless frame. And not going into gamesmanship or not going into a role. Those who are trapped in roles go get into gamesmanship and say, "Well, I'm actually beyond that." And so my role is to teach you how to be beyond what you are, and your role is to be, you know, entertained by me, spiritually entertained by me. And then you're both trapped into roles, the guru, devotee. But we say, no teacher, no teaching, no student. In other words, we're not trapped in any role. We're in the frameless frame, the role-free role. The role-free role. The role-free role. And we do have the right help here. We do have the right help. Sri Sri Anandamayi does help me out quite a bit. I just frustrated because I say I want more. It's never enough. You know, it's never enough. But I'm aware that she's very active in helping me out. But if a day goes by where I don't receive some significant help, I feel abandoned. You know, where are you? You've abandoned me. What are you doing? Come on. What do you, you know, more help. Now, Jordan Spieth, I'm wearing this shirt, he was the greatest putter I've ever seen. He's had putting problems the last couple of years, apparently. I haven't been following golf, so that's what I heard, though. Well, has it abandoned him? No. They said being number one in the world, and the greatest golfer in the world, maybe he said, wow, I mean, this the expectations of that role, I didn't really like it. I didn't like being put into that role, and he realized, there's a very, very heavy role there that people expect me to fulfill, and I don't really want to do that. It's very scary. So, oops, I can't putt as good anymore. That's what happens. He's, you know, sabotaging himself, as it happens to all of us. Ultimately, Tiger Woods sabotaged himself. It was too heavy for him. But what he did was extraordinary for 14 some odd years. Number one, the role that was put on him, the expectations that was put on him were like impossible. Nobody hardly could handle that kind of heavy expectation that was put upon him to satisfy that role. So of course he sabotaged himself to get out of that. You know, who can blame him? Who can blame him? Only those like Anandamayi Ma can be so cause celeb like that, and yet not sabotage themselves. She never sabotaged herself, never. Which is quite extraordinary, isn't it? There was a disappointment in the world that she didn't satisfy. They couldn't fit her into a role. And they basically got tired of her about 1974 or two, maybe 1972. It changed her appearance changed, her everything changed in such a way, is that people finally said, wow, they gave up. It was fun to try to get put her in a role, and they did this dance, but they couldn't do it. And so they kind of said, wow, you're not quite exactly what we want at this point. You know, we thought we could get you into this role, and we couldn't. And so they kind of cooled on her a little bit. And when they cooled on her, they stopped wanting to engage in such an intense way. And so her bliss seemed to be, it became more spacious, and we couldn't quite experience it in the same way. She was more withdrawn. She became more withdrawn. I could see the difference. You're looking at pictures. It's very noticeable. It's very noticeable. Because she says, I'm only here because you want me to be here. If you don't want me to be here, then I will fade away. Okay. I have no desire to be anywhere in particular at all. I mean, I'm everywhere. But this appearance, you wanted this appearance, so you got it. But when they found out they could not pigeonhole and put it into a role, they started to cool on it. But I'm saying to her, I say, hey, I'm not cool on you at all. I haven't cooled at all. Yeah, I mean, come on. I want this role-free, role-less present here. We need that. We need this now. We were desperate for it. What happened was, is that as the modern age got really roaring by 1972, people started saying, hey, you know what? I think a whole bunch of bells and whistles are on their way. So, you know, technology. So they started getting intrigued by what they thought science was going to give them. And they said, well, you know, I wonder if we could use science to help us also be happy. And so we need you to be play a certain role within our expectations of the future. But she couldn't play any role at all. So they started trying to split their attention and became more intrigued about, you know, what modernism can give us. And so that's how it's gone. That's what happened. It really started happening in 1972 very strongly. And then, you know, Apple computer came along, and well, the calculator, HP calculator, I think, started coming out around that time, 72, I believe, first calculators around that time. I remember being a sophomore in high school, and then, and I believe maybe the first calculators had just started to come out by HP, had some Texas Instruments, and some companies had those. And then the Commodore computer was on its way, you know, all this stuff was starting to trickle out, and people were saying, hey, what can we do with this stuff? Maybe we can really define the absence of reality this way. And so, that's what happened, you see. But now we're far enough along with that to recognize what modernism really is about, is again, is trying to make fear, you know, so heavy that it actually creates the absence of reality. And we realize where that goes, and we say, wow, you know, no thank you, we don't want that to be trapped in those roles at all. And we don't want to be trapped in the roles of romanticism either. So we need the one who knows the way to not be trapped in any role at all, the role-free role, which enables bliss to arise, who also understands that there is a great bliss, but that we are not to seek that here. We are to focus on the bliss, the role-free role, the frameless frame. We need that help. We need that help now. So we're revisiting Sri Sri Ananda Mai Ma, that expression of the oneness, and saying, you know, we need your help. We're not going to trap you into the role of a guru or a mother, okay? No. We're going to pay attention to your advice. You know, we're going to pay attention to it. We're desperate for it. We're desperate for Dharma King advice right now. We're desperate for it. So that's the focus I have. We are desperate for it. We absolutely need it. And many, many, many need it. They just are kind of frozen. But the frozen cry, this man I spoke with yesterday, he's like frozen. He's starting to freeze up. And he's crying like, man, I feel it. And I'm not sure I can do it. I don't know if I can get free of it. I said, you got to jump on it right now. You know, you got to start it right now. And I gave him a lot of advice, which really was advice to myself, that I need to jump on the next phase right now. And I got to stop eating chips and nuts and snacking. And I started at 6 to 6 again. I started it yesterday. So I got to get started. And that's the advice I gave him. And he was telling me how bad it is, chips and dips in the evening. And that's what I've been doing. So I realized, oh my gosh, you know, together we help one another greatly. Very, very helpful. He's been through a lot. That man has been through a lot. I could tell. And he's learned a lot from it. Wow. Amazing serendipity there. Amazing synchronicity. All right, somebody needs something. I got to help them out. So wonderful sharing this time here with you. And very, very, very profound. I can just feel it from head to toe. Just, I'm in just this reverberation here because we're really able to focus in on this, and that's quite shocking how clear our focus is here. Very auspicious focus. Okay, so just realize you got this boogie board and you can just hold on to it and float in it, right? You're in a pool, but you kind of lost sight of the pool deck and you don't know where you are. You're just kind of in the water somewhere. Just hold on to this boogie board. Just float for a while. Just float in the wow, and it'll subside after a while. The shock will subside. Okay, very great. That's it for this one. Full stop in the wow.